With that, welcome to another installment here on Out to Lunch. This is WKCR in New York, 89.9 on your FM dial. It's 3 minutes after 12. Lauren Schoenberg with you, as I am every Friday afternoon, Thursday afternoon. And we're very happy to have as our guest this afternoon none other than Mr. Ruby Braff. Ruby. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning. How are you?
Good morning. And want to thank you for taking the time and energy to get up so early in the morning.
Oh, it's fun being up at this hour. Thanks for inviting me.
Okay, let's get a record.
Don't tell anybody I'm up.
Huh? Okay, I won't tell anybody you're up. Let's get underway with some music. We'll get our mic level set and everything. We just arrived at the studio. We're going to turn to one of my all-time favorite records, and knowing how self-critical Ruby is about his own records, I have a feeling that he'd even like this one himself. The Ruby Braff George Barnes Quartet, their first album on Chiaroscuro CR-121. And we'll start out with Oh That Kiss. Our guest, Ruby Braff, along with on this album, John Giuffrida on the bass, Wayne Wright rhythm guitar, and late George Barnes electric guitar. Thank you. All right. From the first album on Chiaroscuro Records, the Ruby Braff George Barnes Quartet, Oh That Kiss. And again, we're going to welcome our guest, Ruby Braff. Now that his mic is working, you might be able to hear his dulcet tones. And let's get underway with just talking about what's going on now. I know that you did a cross-country tour with George Ween.
I didn't do anything with George Ween. I did a cross-country tour, and sometimes he was on it. I never do anything with George Ween or with anybody. That takes care of that.
Okay, Ruby.
We went every place in the country, every place, and we had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
John Bunch played piano.
I see.
Very often, and we had Scott and a lot of Eddie Hubble and
Slam.
And wonderful Slam Stewart. And it was really fun going everywhere, and be surprised. People love good music everywhere. Sorry, excuse me.
That's okay.
So it's nice.
Yeah. Yeah, it is nice. What's coming up in the future, just to start right off the bat with 1983?
Lots of things. I have many things planned to record, and I'm planning a very special kind of a musical outfit, but I can't say very much about it, not because it's so secretive, it's because it's so complicated for me, that there are so many aspects of it that I wouldn't know where to start with. So
is it going to be a small band?
That's just it. There's no way to know what it's going to be. I mean, it sounds funny, but it's
But there's
true.
Something in the works.
Yeah, there's all kinds of situations going on. Really, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know you go to Europe quite frequently, a few times a year at least.
I only go to Europe to earn money. I never go to Europe because I like Europe. I hate Europe.
You'll take the Bronx.
I'd much rather be in America, sometimes you just have to go to those places. There's a reason why they call it the Old World. It's because it's old and rotten, and that's why everybody escaped there and came here. You know.
I hope Benny's listening.
Although I love London. London is a ball. That really is fun. That you can wander around and look in windows and stores and apartments and until they catch you.
Until they catch you.
Yeah.
All right. We started off with hearing part of that the great quartet you had with the late George Barnes. I remember being at that premiere concert you did where you were
in Carnegie Hall.
At Carnegie Hall on the same bill with the Benny Goodman Quartet.
Yeah, right.
And it was quite an accomplishment. Many of the people that were there actually felt that this was something new and fresh, and certainly didn't suffer by comparison in the least.
No,
of course.
No, it was nice, and the minute we began playing you could tell that the people liked it very much. You know, they responded to it nicely.
Yeah.
They were nice people.
How long was the group together?
About 15 minutes.
Relatively speaking.
No, I'd say about maybe 2 or 3 years, I think. I'm not quite certain.
During that time, you had a chance to record quite a bit. I know there's an
album
or two.
We did about 6, 7 albums, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. At the time of that. The group, as it was, that we listened to on those titles that open the show with John Jufrida and Wayne Wright. I think the personnel changed after a little while. Michael Moore came in with
him? Yeah, we got Michael, yeah.
Michael Moore came on the bass, and Wayne Wright stayed in there?
Wayne hung in there, right. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. On the acoustic guitar, the arrangements you did, were they pretty much just head arrangements, or did they take some preparation and
sometimes
rehearsal?
Little,
of course
they did. But they were basically head arrangements, you know. But we rehearsed all the time, you know.
Yeah, I remember you used to rehearse downtown,
all the time,
in the village somewhere.
We rehearsed for everything. Even when we were having a fight, we rehearsed that.
Gracing the back of the record jacket on your first album with that quartet on Chiaroscuro Records is a sketch signed by Benedetto, 1973.
That's Tony.
I believe that's Tony Bennett.
Yeah.
He's
become a terrific artist since then. He does wonderful, wonderful paintings now.
Really?
Yeah.
You mean color things?
Yeah. Oils and watercolors and everything.
Your association with Tony Bennett, was that in any way linked with Bobby Hackett and his...
Well, as a matter of fact, it was Bobby Hackett that introduced me years ago to Tony, and that's how we got to know each other. And I used to run out and do tours with, accompanying Tony. And eventually Tony, and it took a lot of guts to do this, had us do a big tour with just the quartet instead of 32 and 35 men. And
sometimes he took some criticism for it because his fans were used to hearing, you know, large. But Tony's the kind of a guy that will try anything because he loves jazz music, you know.
Yeah. He has great taste. I believe that the quartet also did an album with him back at that time period, didn't they?
We did two albums.
Two.
And we even, one time, we did a few records that were on the jukebox with strings. Tori Zito wrote a bunch of strings for just the quartet and Tony. We did some of These Days and a tune from Touch of Class, All That Waste of Love, that George Barry wrote for the movie. Not a bad tune either. And some other tune, which I never got to hear.
Yeah. Let's go back and hear something else from the quartet, and then we're going to look through our pile of records here and then find some things that will spur on some conversation, Ruby.
By the way, I just mention something to you, in case anyone, the many fans of Buddy Rich might want to know that I spoke with him last night at the hospital, and he's coming around, and he's going to be okay.
Beautiful.
So
beautiful. Yeah, I think everybody's best wishes were with Buddy, and he's going to come through. And
he's wonderful.
Just a matter of resting, I guess, taking it easy.
He wanted to go out and work last night.
Okay, we're glad to know that Buddy Rich is okay, and we're even happier to know that we've got Ruby Braff up here in the record in the radio studio this afternoon, and we're going to listen to something else from first album of the Ruby Braff George Barn Quartet, With Time to Love. Thank you. That's beautiful. Not only is it a beautiful interpretation, but that's your tune?
Yes, I wrote that tune a long time ago, yeah, sure.
So it wasn't written especially for this band, it was written actually quite before?
I wrote it before, but I told them that I wrote it for them, so that they would feel good about it. And then as soon as they got to like it and felt they don't, I said, I wrote it for everybody.
Yeah.
That's what Beethoven used to do, you know.
Really?
He was an out-and-out liar and rascal, and he would write a symphony and send it to someone and say, you're the first and only person that has this. And they'd say, how wonderful, maestro, and we're going to perform it on the October 14th. And all over the world on October 14th, various orchestras were performing it. Then they all sued him.
Oh, my God.
That's the kind of a guy Ludwig was.
I always thought there was some strains of Beethoven in you, Ruby. Listen, you're not enough jazz musicians of your caliber and stature and everything write, and especially write beautiful tunes
what?
Like
I'm sorry.
That. Not that many musicians write their own originals, you know.
Oh.
And where did writing come in for you? When did you get the urge to write your own tunes?
Well, hearing
way back,
hearing wonderful tunes anytime will inspire you to, you know, to nice thoughts like that. I don't consider myself a writer, no more than I consider any of your jazz players, composers. I mean, everybody's a composer. How can one of these guys and one of these groups call himself a composer and Ravel is a composer? One of them is not a composer.
What is the other one? He's a writer.
No, he's just a foolish child who thinks he's something and he's just writing a couple of little licks and that doesn't make you a composer. But in this frivolous world of music where you're allowed to do strange things, I guess it's okay.
Hmm. You wrote that tune.
Duke Ellington is a composer.
I'll call you a composer for writing that.
Well, then if I'm a composer, then Duke Ellington is a moon.
Okay. Oh, bad. Where did you get the idea to put together a quartet with two guitars and a bass?
Well,
because, you know, there was the Hot Club of France with two guitars and a bass.
Yeah, well, I always liked that sound, but I particularly like, George was a very unique player, and he had a way of blending with a horn that I never heard any, he could bend notes, like, actually like a very rare, and we decided to have a little trio, and then I said, wait a minute, I said, who's going to accompany you when you take a solo? And then we got a rhythm guitar player, you know, so that's how that happened. And we never needed drums because we could count, you know. And there's no sense having drums unless they're the greatest.
That's true. So you had a drumless quartet that actually had, I guess, quite a bit of success. And did the group terminated when George passed away? Or I believe you had actually broken up before that, hadn't it?
Yeah, I think a little before that. But he was an unusual. He really was an unusual artist. He could play the hell out of that guitar. I don't think there were many people that could handle that instrument as marvelously as he could, you know.
Yeah, I don't think so either. It was a very unique group, and
yeah.
I'd strongly, you know, suggest if you can find any of their records. Some were done for the RCA label, and you might still
some
see
were for Concord. We did a couple for Concord, if I'm not mistaken. Gershwin, and a very, very good Rodgers and Hart album, like the one you see that we did with Tony Bennett. These wonderful tunes. We liked them so much that we ended up recording them, the whole thing, ourselves as well.
Oh, gee.
Because there were verses and things that we liked on them and all that, you know.
Yeah.
Beautiful tunes.
Yeah. Beautiful band. I'd like to hear one more thing from this.
You can do anything you want.
Okay. We're going to hear another tune from the Ruby Braff George Barnes Quartet, then we'll get into some other topics and get into maybe some of the background of Ruby's career. I'd like to find out about where and why he is. And let's go with Looking at You. What's the background on this tune? How'd you run across Looking at You?
Oh, I remember Lee Wiley doing that years ago with those some wonderful guys, maybe Bushkin and those guys. I'm not sure, maybe Hackett. And it's a beautiful tune, very, very lovely.
Looking at You.
Yeah, nice tune.
Our guest, Ruby Braff.
Thank you.
Yeah. I guess you haven't heard that record in a while.
No, I never listened to my records.
I don't blame you.
I don't blame you either.
It's not easy to listen to your own records. You know, Ruby, you're very self, as any great musician would be, you know, very self-critical when you look back at your own things. And I remember talking to you a long time ago when you really weren't interested in discussing too much or listening too much to your albums, you know, the many, many albums that you made in the 50s when you were the young hot trumpet man from Boston recording for RCA Victor Records and all kinds of salute to different artists. And just quickly in an overview, how do you, or actually you can take as long as you want, we've got till 3 o'clock. how do you view your development, and what is it about those early things that you find?
Well, nobody likes to hear things of themselves when they weren't playing any good at all, you know. And it takes a long time to learn to play, and it's only in the last 2 weeks that I've learned how to play, actually, so, you know.
Yeah.
It takes a long time, and the worst thing is to have heard so many wonderful records of great plays. It makes it very hard to like your own, you know. I mean, how excited can I get about me when I can turn on a Louis Armstrong record, you know?
Yeah.
Look at it that way.
You're still with us and creating.
So is Louis. He sounds better dead than most people I hear alive, so it really doesn't matter.
Okay. We're going to turn to Louis Armstrong as soon as Ruby and I got in the car on the way down today. Soon enough, the topic of conversation turned to Louis, who really is such a paramount figure in, I guess, both of our lives and in most musicians. Pretty much everything all comes back to him. So we're going to hear one of the early classics, one of the first jazz duos, Louis and Earl Hines, 1928, Ooh. Weatherbird.
Oh, boy.
And then we'll come back, and that'll be a nice catalyst for bringing us back to the early days of Ruby's career, and we can talk about his early inspirations and all that kind of stuff. Louis Armstrong and Earl Hines, one of Ruby's favorite records, I think it's fair to say, Weatherbird. Not going to be Weatherbird. How about Muggles?
What's the difference to... Thank you.
Glad Louis had a head full of hair so he didn't have to deal with those things.
Yeah. He had everything.
He sure did. We heard Muggles
he
first.
Had a wonderful Earl Hines on there, too.
And then Weatherbird.
Yeah.
Was Louis Armstrong your first inspiration?
Oh, no, no. I used to listen to the... We had wonderful things. The radio was always on and when I was a kid in Boston. And the pop music of the day was... All the wonderful things you hear, Benny and Tommy and this and that. And
the big bands.
Yeah, and everything. Nat Cole and Fats and where it all started. You know, and there was, hearing Benny and sing. And then you see them in the movies, too, dressed up beautifully, playing and everything. And it would make you want to do the same things. Say, gee, I got to do that. So I'd play with the radio all day with those guys.
So that's where it started for you?
Born that's in where Boston. It all started.
Born right in Boston?
Yeah. In Boston. We had a weird ambulance driver. This guy used to go by my house every day and hear me making noise in the horn, and he'd always say, he'd be coming home from his, have you heard Louis Armstrong yet? And I'd say, who's that? You know, and he was very disgusted. And one day, listening to the radio, I heard this magical sound that it filled the room with complete orange. It was like an extraterrestrial thing happening, you know. And they said, you're hearing the music of Louis Armstrong. And without even knowing why or what was so good about it, because you don't when you're that young, it just absolutely made your whole body vibrate with its sound. And it's no horn ever sounded like that, you know. And it just made the room... completely different.
Yeah,
I used to comb the dial from then on in looking for him, you know.
Yeah. Were you playing trumpet by this time?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure.
When did when and how?
Don't be that way.
That's what. Where and when did the trumpet come into your hands? Was it school? Was it a kid band? What was
Or
cornet? What was it?
No, it was a trumpet. I kept asking for a saxophone all the time, and they thought I didn't know what I was talking about, and they brought me this idiotic thing. They went to the con company and got something my size. that was in 1935. I think I was about 7 or 8 years old. And mm-hmm. I wouldn't even play it for many months. I hated it so much, but they wouldn't take it back, so I was stuck with it, you know.
So you're playing in school bands? Teachers at
no,
school?
No, we had no bands. We did have a guy in school that for 25 cents once a week would give you some. He was an old, wonderful man, an old circus, a former circus trumpet player, you know, like a classical. And they'd give you little marches and finger rings to play and stuff like that, you know. And it was pretty awful. And I went to his house and took a couple lessons, and he died, and that was the end of him, you know.
Sure.
But I got most of my playing experience playing with the radio.
Playing with the radio.
I played with everybody, with Benny, with Fats, with the name it. You know, it was a ball.
Yeah. So, but early on, Louis Armstrong came over the radio and kind of turned your head around. How about the other trumpet players and trumpet players around Boston? Bobby Hackett had been up there.
Well, Bobby was,
he was
from
Providence.
He played. He played in Boston a lot, but he was far too sophisticated for me to understand. I wouldn't know what it wasn't until I was about 14 years old that I heard and went bananas hearing a beautiful Bobby Hackett record. And even it's so beautiful, I didn't know quite how beautiful it was because I didn't know the changes he was playing anything against. But it was still, same with Pops, it was still so... Great music is such, it has such magical powers that it grabs you whether you're an idiot or a genius, you know. And I was on the other end of the scale. So it's just like, imagine a kid trying to hear Pee Wee Russell would sound like a lot of squawks and silly noises. You'd have to have very sophisticated taste to know how good he is, you know. It was much easier for me to like Artie Shaw or Tommy or any of the other orchestras, you know, that was much, not that they weren't wonderful, you know.
Yeah.
And of course the great Benny Goodman and Count Basie and the, oh God, yeah. That was wonderful.
When, as long as we're talking about, you mentioned Basie, when did Prez first grab your ear? Did you hear him back in the Basie days, or were you a little too young?
Yeah, well, I mean, I heard every, the whole world was records and live broadcasts. Let me explain, if you have a second, I'll tell you about that. When we were kids, we knew different guys, different houses that had different record collections. There were cats that had all Basies and Billies, guys that had only Dukes. There were guys, one guy, the greatest, the Mayo Duca, had nothing but Louis Armstrong's, every record that Louis had, and their alternates and duplicates. And it was like going to school. You weren't even allowed to touch his records, you know. If you put your hand on it, he'd kill you. And he would say, where did I leave off with you? 1938, this was it this take or that take? And that's the way it would begin.
Yeah.
And he would tell us everything, every story that Louis brought with him to that studio that day. Because Louis was a buddy of his and used to come and stay in his house when he would be there and listen to his own records and type letters to people and do what he... So we'd have to sit there and suffer and get high and have coffee and... Mayo was addicted to coffee, and every single room had a coffee pot going. And if I would get there at 7 o'clock at night, it would be, finally by 10 o'clock he would start to play the records because he would have to tell thousands of stories. But to continue, every house that we went to had different records. Some had only Bob Crosby records.
Right.
See? So that, and then you'd hear all the older fellows talk about what they thought about each record, and you would gain a concept of why they liked this or didn't like it or so on and so forth. But the magnificent thing was that the radio played wonderful music all the time. And at 11 o'clock every night, from 11 to 2 in the morning, from all over the country, live,
yeah,
you heard from the such and such, Louis Armstrong, Fats Waller, this one, that one.
Jesus.
When I was supposed to be fast asleep, my ear was glued to this little tiny radio, playing all these things from everywhere till 2 in the morning. That's why I hated school, because getting up in the morning was just a drag.
Must
you know?
Have been, yeah.
While they were talking about geography, I was thinking of, what does Stuff Smith play? What was that second tune he played last night? You know, and that's how we get to know a lot of things about it. You know.
Yeah, so you had the opportunity to catch all those artists at their prime creating live on the radio,
yeah,
every evening.
That was
incredible.
That was it.
So there was a group of jazz aficionados and collectors.
Everybody had records everywhere. Yeah.
Were you one of the only musicians among the bunch, or were many of them musicians?
Oh, no, mostly
musicians.
Most of them were musicians. A few weren't, but Mayo Duca was a wonderful original trumpet player, and himself he played wonderful. And all the cats were very, very good players. I was the youngest, and most of the time I used to sub in nightclubs for them when they would have a better gig.
Right.
You know, on weekends or whatever, you know.
So that's how the professional
career
started for you, with subbing on club dates and things like that.
No, I worked in joints, not club dates.
A joint, you mean?
I worked in joints and nightclubs where they used to throw, the bouncer was... used to hear you play, and if he didn't like your playing, he'd take you and your coat and your horn and throw you out physically onto the street. And they threw people out onto the street that sounded like Louis Armstrong compared to the people that are playing jazz concerts today. Okay? That's what cats sound like to me a lot of times these days.
Sure.
But okay. Sure.
We can get into that in a little while.
I'm just telling you.
We had some great observations. It's true, and I'll tell you the truth. I'd like to talk about that stuff, about the way that maybe some of the some of Louis' contemporaries and younger younger people viewed him and in relation to actually where he was coming from and all that. That's kind of interesting.
Where are they coming from is what I want to know.
Okay.
And where are they going to?
Louis Armstrong, let's catch Sweethearts on Parade, where he kind of laid out what was going to happen over the next 20 years.
You know who
years.
Wrote that tune?
Yes.
Lombardo's brother. There.
Carmen Lombardo. Mm-hmm. Hold it, Carmen. Sweethearts on Parade.
Sometimes I wonder why I spend such lonely nights. Oh, baby, lonely nights. dreaming of a song, melody, memory, and I'm once again with you. When our love was new, each kiss an inspiration. Now that baby you know, long ago, beside a garden wall, when stars are bright and you are in my arms, baby, the nightingales tell